Okay. Good morning. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Selamat pagi dan salam sejahtera. Peace be upon you. Tadi saya tanya Pak Edi moderator saya pakai bahasa apa gitu kan. Karena saya melihat sebagian besar wajahnya mirip saya gitu kan. Matanya sipit, kulitnya hitam gitu. Tapi banyak tamu juga dari asing. Saya udah agak-agak lupa bahasa Inggris, sudah 6 tahun nggak sekolah. Tapi mungkin saya akan mix gitu ya. So my story today, my background is from computer science, Department of Electrical Engineering and Information Technology. So my topic is around IT, around computer science. So apologize to whom attendee, professor who come from other background. So I try to give a simple story, simple presentation, less technical, and hopefully we all together can have something from my presentation. So my title is Big Data Retold from Analytic to Machine Intelligence. So as the title said, is retold, meaning that it's already their story out. Ada cerita di luar sana, there's story out there that you might or might not heard about it. But anyway, I'm going to retell the story again from my personal point of view. So happy. Please, if you want to make comment or disagree, I'm more than welcome. And also, I will present some story about research that have been done in Indonesia, in our university. I come from UGM anyway, and also from worldwide. Just a funny quote about data. In God we trust, but all others must bring data. So data is important because the one that we trust is only God. Human or others must bring proof. Yeah, this is about a small story about myself. Pak Edi, I think, already mentioned some of them. Now about big data. How big is big data? I think big data now is become in the computer science, in information technology, is a new buzzword. Buzzword is like bee, seperti lebah gitu ya, berdengung, buzzing, buzzword. Everybody talk about it, everybody claim to do it, but rarely actually know many about it. So how big is big data? So there's a big data, of course there's small data. Usually every day we deal with small data. We have data in our laptop. Everybody of you have laptop, you have a mobile phone. The capacity is now I think is from 32 gigabit up until 128 gigabit for mobile phone. In laptop you have like 250 gigabit to 500 gigabit. Maybe for some desktop you have like 500 giga to 1 tera. Some have 2 tera, but now it's not common yet. So if we look back to our history, maybe some of you know this kind of what it is, device of things, audio tape. But if you're a millennial, you born like 1990 or 2000 maybe, you don't know this. So ini adalah tape gitu ya, tape, audio tape. Ini ada pitanya, there's oops. Ada pita hanya ini isinya data, but this is manual, sorry, analog audio tape, so it's not digital yet. Founded in 1963, audio tape, and the capacity is only around 600 something kilobit. So it's very small, 600 something kilobit, but anyway, it can store songs, believe me, it can store songs up until maybe 15 to 20 songs. Fast forward, we have floppy disks. Now floppy disk is also gone, and nowadays we have optical disk. So as you see in this presentation, there's optical disk range from CD 400 megabit, there's a DVD 4.7 gigabit until now Blu-ray 25 gigabit. So the storage become bigger and bigger, and the price also become cheaper. So if you see, this is audio tape around kilobit, now become gigabit. The size is become smaller, the price become cheaper. That's why we can store all the data now. We take picture with our mobile phone, put in our mobile phone or store in laptop. We download MP3, we download movie, and we can all store in our devices. So imagine a server like YouTube, Google, or Facebook, how big is their storage? So that's the big data coming. How much data in the world? Berapa banyak data yang ada di dunia ini? Actually, no one really knows. So tidak ada seorang pun yang tahu benar-benar berapa gitu. Yang ada adalah perkiraan itu like estimation can be plus or minus, can be wrong or can be right. Interestingly, 90% data produced in recent years, so in the last 10 to 15 years, 90% of the world data is produced. Jadi data diproduksi 15 tahun terakhir. Sebelumnya tidak terlalu banyak data. 15 tahun lalu, 20 tahun lalu belum ada YouTube. There's no Facebook back there. Google only 15 years. So only in the last 10 to 15 years, the most of the data is produced. IDC estimates, IDC itu lembaga penelitian, International Data Corporation. IDC is one of the leading research institute in terms of data, in terms of computer science. They estimate that in 2011, 1.8 zettabytes, trillion of gigabit, 21 to the power of 10 of bytes. So di 2011 itu sudah ada 1.8 zettabyte data. Intinya datanya sangat besar. 2012 2.8 naik hampir dua kali lipatnya, dan estimated in the 2020 there will be 40 zettabytes of data. So this is big data. Not only big, this is huge data. I give this some definition if you want to know exactly what's meaning of petabyte, zettabytes, yottabytes, and etc. So this is the data that there's in the world right now. This is one of the earliest definition of big data. So I will read it for you. Big data is characterized as high volume, volumenya besar, ukurannya besar, high velocity, kecepatannya besar, and of variety information assets that demand cost effective. So the earliest definition of big data consists of 3V, 3V, volume, velocity, and variety. Ada volume, ada kecepatan, dan there's variety atau keberagaman data. The demand constructive, innovative form of information processing that enable enhanced insight, decision making, and process automation. So maybe some of you question, so what's the difference between small data and big data anyway in terms of processing? Technology-wise, it's different. Why? Because the conventional technology who deal with small data cannot cope atau tidak bisa menangani the big data. Usually if you have database or you have data in your laptop, maybe you play with the engine like Excel or MySQL or Access. Usually you only deal with megabit of data. But some database technology will struggle to deal with gigabit of data or even terabit of data or even more. That's why the technology, the big data need a certain type of technology. Enable enhanced insight. So big data need insight. Insight mean pemahaman. Pemahamannya lebih karena datanya lebih banyak, maka butuh atau menuntut menghasilkan pemahaman yang lebih. This is another definition of big data. So the initial definition consists of 3V: volume, velocity, and variety. Now evolve into 5V. Adding veracity and also value. Now if you read in the internet, sometimes some author will say 8V, sometimes they even more. But for me, let us stick with 3V or 5V. So there is veracity. Veracity means the how we confidence about the data. Is the data the correctness of the data? And the value means how the data can generate value to the business or to the enterprise. So there's a 3V and the 5V. Fast forward, so how we, for company or for business, how we create value from big data? Is this just another buzzword or is this just another IT guy who wants to create new confusion? The important things is if you have data, you have more data, and then the data should give more value to the company, right? So let me go back to this definition. Volume means ukuran. So if small data, yeah, some people said at small data is less than tera. So if you have that data less than 100 tera, it's small data. If you have data more than 100 tera, means you have big data. And you need special machine, special hardware, special technology. You need Hadoop, you need Spark to deal with it. This is volume. The second definition is velocity. Velocity means that big data deal with many speed of data. Some data come in real time. So like Twitter, like stream Facebook is real time. But big data also deal with a batch processing. Also there's a near time. So that's also second characteristic of velocity in big data. Variety, you have different forms of data source. In variety, you have database. It calls structured data. So if you have table, you have that structured data. But big data not only deal with the structured data like database, but also deal with unstructured data. So like your document, you have MS Word document. We have TXT. You have tweet. You have Facebook. You have LinkedIn message. So all of them is input to the big data. So big data will deal with the structured data like database, unstructured data like social media data, also semi-structured data. If you familiar with HTML tag, if you familiar with XML, then it falls in this category. The fourth V is a veracity, so you have to sure that the data is correct, which is not easy. And the last V is value. You have to generate value to the company. So this is the 5V of big data, and I would like to emphasize more in this value. How a business can derive value from the big data? How to create value from big data? Thanks to the big data technology, now we can immensely extend our memory and computational power to help us answer some more questions. Say we want to have, we have a question. Say we are a government, kita pemerintah, dan kita ingin mengeluarkan kebijakan baru, say undang-undang yang baru atau peraturan pemerintah. Say we are a government agency, we wants to have a bill or any peraturan, regulation, and we want to know how the public, bagaimana masyarakat, public perception, bagaimana masyarakat berpikir terhadap kebijakan yang akan dikeluarkan pemerintah. So we can have big data to collect opinion from social media like Twitter, Facebook, and using some technology often called NLP, natural language processing, we will know the sentiment. Sentiment. Jadi kita bisa mengekstrak sentiment atau opini or opinion from this social data. So there's some more question. In order to derive value, we have to do analytics atau kita harus melakukan analisis. Nah, analytics, there's many kind of analytics. I present you in this presentation. There's five types of analytics. Dilihat dari kacamata orang IT or statistician. Ada lima macam dari analytics. Ini analytics macamnya. Ini adalah human. So sejauh mana manusia itu ikut campur tangan terhadap analytics-nya. Analytics menghasilkan decision, dan decision diikuti oleh aksi. Or there's an action coming from decision that's made. So we have data here. We have database data, we have social media data, we have Twitter data, or any data. And from the data we want to get value. To get value, we do analytics. So what's the difference between those four types of analytics? The first thing is descriptive. We want to know what happened. Umumnya, generally, if we do query, if we do reporting, report to our boss, supervisor, we do this type of analytic, descriptive analytic. Secondly, there's a diagnostic analytics. It try to answer why did it happen, kenapa sesuatu itu terjadi. And the third is predictive, means we try to know in the future what will happen in the future, so we do prediction, kita melakukan perkiraan. And lastly, prescriptive, so it's kind of we give prescription, kita memberikan resep. Jadi tidak hanya mengetahui apa yang terjadi, kita melakukan diagnosis, tapi kita juga memberikan resep. Mirip dokter yang memberikan resep ke pasien. Bedanya apa? The difference is all this thing is done by machine, dilakukan oleh mesin. Our big data analytics. As you see that the involvement or influence of human is vary from the first type of analytics to the last one. In the descriptive analytics, you still have more human involved. A majority of the analytics is still done by human before come to the decision. And in diagnosis, the human involvement has become less. And predictive also become more and more less. And in the last one, and the prescriptive one, there's no human involved. All done by machine automatically. Some types of prescriptive analytics, even decision is made by machine itself. So it's called autonomous system, automation. Machine do all the analytics, and even they do the action. So like autonomous car, there's some type of prescriptive analytics who they do the action by themselves. So the value creation of different types of analytics is different as well. This is the value generated to the enterprises or the company, and this is the complexity. So the value is increased from descriptive to prescriptive. The descriptive, you have insight. Insights mean you know what already happened. This is descriptive. Descriptive means the data is there, kejadiannya itu sudah terjadi, dan tapi kita ingin tahu. And insight, so you know the context, the relation in terms of diagnosis, prescriptive. In the predictive and prescriptive one, you have foresight. So you kind of predict the future. You want to know the trend of the future. But the complexity also increase from descriptive to complexity. Jadi descriptive itu common. Prescriptive or predictive is not common. Why? Because it's more complex. The data is more complex, the time needed also longer. Descriptive analytics is still the most useful. So this is the research done by Gartner in 2014. I got from the source. You can download it yourself. Descriptive analytics still account for 70% of the analytics done. This is worldwide. Diagnostics 30%, predictive 16%, and prescriptive is only 3%. So if you see, the more complex the prediction, the less people at the company use it. So you can see that prescriptive analytics only 3% of the whole initiative of analytics in big data. You have structured data, like I said previously. Why descriptive analytics is account for majority? Because it does using a structured data. Most company have database, have data. University has data. So like UGM, we only now doing the descriptive. Why? Because we have our own data in database. Pak Widodo punya Prisma, kan? Pak Edi punya maybe sistem informasi di MIPA. Why? Because it's easy or the easiest. Because mostly we employ the structured data. The more complex, we need unstructured or contained data. We need social media data, we need a document, and not all the document have different structure. Twitter and Facebook has different structure. We can download Twitter data, but only for limited number. We cannot download free Facebook data. So it's kind of it's not easy to get this data. So that's why the analytics mostly in a descriptive one. But yes, like I said before, this is data in 2014. IBM also make a survey company. Most of them interested to do big data itself. Usually, only very big company, multinational company, doing predictive or prescriptive, right? Because they all have all the data about themselves. Like Google, they have our own data. They have their own data. We voluntarily give our data to Google or Facebook or YouTube or Instagram now. So they have their own data to do their own analytics. This is not so clear. but like I told you previously, university also do some analytics. We have dashboard here. Yeah, this is some statistic about employee or pegawai, how many employee in the university, how many students we have, and etc. This is descriptive analytics. This is another example of diagnostic analytics based on public transport data. We involve in team with some company in Jogja, and also we cooperate with Transjakarta. So for your information, UGM has subsidiary called INO, and INO deal with payment of Transjakarta. So pembayaran tiket Transjakarta. Every year approximately there's 110 million transaction of public transport in Jakarta. So in average there's around 350,000 transaction per day, account for half terabyte of data. So we get this data and we try to analytics on this transport, public transport data. Actually, there's a map here. This is map of Jakarta. There's blue colors and there's also red colors. The color is represent the corridor. Corridors means jalur or street where the bus pass. Jadi jalur di mana bisnya itu lewat. Itu dinamakan koridor. Nah, yang biru dan merah ini adalah jalur bis yang lewat. So what's different between blue color and red color? The blue color represents people or passenger who going in to the bus stop halte. Jadi biru itu penumpang yang masuk ke halte Transjakarta. The red color represent the passenger who going out from the bus stop. Jadi yang biru yang masuk, yang merah yang keluar. So we can see that the red one, the red sub corridor, most of people going out from the bus to in this sub corridor. Maybe this is the street who has many offices. Mungkin ini adalah jalan yang banyak, kantor-kantornya. Nah, the blue one maybe is around houses, houses complex. Mungkin halte-halte yang dekat ke perumahan. And if you look into the number more, and you can see that there's a one sub corridor, this one, who account for more than 46% of the going in traffic. The other is only small number, 3%, 6%, this is 6%, 8%. So this is, we can identify that some sub corridor, the majority of people is going into the bus in that sub corridors. So what kind of value that the Transjakarta can derive from this analytics? So for instance, we can suggest them that, okay, put more buses in this sub corridor, or less buses in other sub corridor. If we look into the time of this peak, we can say that this certain amount of time, please add buses, this sub corridor. So this is one example of the value that the big data analytics can give to a company. In this example is Transjakarta company. This is another actually detailed explanation of this one. This graph shows the time series of the entry is the blue one, the entry and going to the bus stop, and the red one is the exit one. So using this analytics, we can see what's the peak of certain bus stop. This is another example of diagnostic analytics and descriptive that we've done for the. Actually, we done it. We do it for the government, for Indonesian public university entry exam. So in Indonesia, the entry exam to the public university, Universitas Negeri, is conducted collectively, dilakukan bersama-sama setiap tahun. Maybe most of you will familiar. There's two types of entry exam for public university. It called SNMPTN and SBMPTN. SNMPTN means seleksi nasional mahasiswa perguruan tinggi negeri. SBMPTN seleksi bersama. SNMPTN is by invitation. SNMPTN is by invitation using rapport. I don't know how you call it in English, rapport. Maybe grade. Yeah. Grade from high school. So if I want to entry university from SNMPTN, I just need to submit my grade from high school. No need to take a written exam. But SBMPTN means that we need to do a written exam. So, why this analytic is performed? Because the government or the committee of the exam wants to know which one is better. The selection by invitation or selection by written exam. Better means that
portion.
Yes. Better means, of course, IP, index prestati. What do you call index prestati in English?
IP.
Mark. Grade. And also by the
time.
Pemerataan. What do you call pemerataan in English? Apa baik pemerataan? Equality? Equal distribution. Thanks. Equal distribution between the students. Because there's a kecurigaan, there's suspicion that SNMPTN only serve students who come from Java. Why? Because, of course, the quality of high school in Java is better than most of the high school in not in Java, like Jayapura, Maluku, Kalimantan. So the suspicion that the distribution is not equal. So that's why this analytic is performed. And actually you can see from the color. So, if you go to entry to the SNMPTN or SBMPTN, you have you given three choices. Yeah, choice one maybe I don't know UGM, second choice some university in Madura, third choice some university in Kalimantan. Yeah. So you given three choices. The blue one is the first choice, the green one is second choice, and the red one is the third choice. So you can see that in this picture, the upper picture, majority of students who accepted is the blue one, meaning that university itself given preference to the students who choose their university as the first choices. If there's a student, even though they're clever, but they goes to UGM, but UGM is second choice to SMPTN, most likely will be rejected. Comparably, you can see in the SBMPTN, in the, how is it called, written exam, you can see that it's more nicely distributed. So there's no domination of blue colors like the first one. So what we can deduce from this analytics that SBMPTN is somehow more distributed to the preference or choice of the students. This is another graph, shows this is still same initiatives. This is also SNMPTN, this is SBMPTN. You can see that the distribution of SNMPTN still heavily concentrate in Java Island. And there's also another graph that I'm not so here. So we look into the IPK grade from SBMPTN, SNMPTN. We collect sample from 110 public university. All we ask them to submit the IP, the grade IPK of all of their students, and we categorize whether the students goes from the invitation or from the written exam. We can see that, or interestingly, that a student who came from SBMPTN perform better than student who come from invitation exam. So that's why in start from last year, the government make change to the the policy, to the regulation. They reduce the percentage number of students who admitted from the invitation because of this analytics. Usually, previously, as SNMPTN or invitation, at least is 50%. Last year, it's become 40%. Maybe, I'm not sure this year, maybe even less. But this is, that policy has come from this study. Another example of the analytics, like I said previously, if we want to have value from the social media, if we want to know how people think or how people opine, make opinion, we can see video from the social media analytics. From this is not so clear, but this is I take from the Twitter. The keyword is ICST. So this conference, there's some 49 tweet from 28 people. This is the I think this is the impression. You can see this graph showing this is the time, this is the number of tweet. So let's focus in this one. We can do sentiment. So we ask the social media, what's the opinion, what's your sentiment about ICST? There's three color of it. The green is the positive sentiments, meaning that people happy, people give appraisal, oh good, very good, nice, that's the positive sentiment. And the right one is the negative sentiments. Maybe people complain about this conference. So there's a 10% of a positive one, there's a 2% of negative sentiments. Majority is the blue one. Blue one is neutral. Natural means this is the tweet, the message does not contain statement words, meaning only informational. Jadi hanya sekedar informasi. Kalau informasi, pemberitahuan, pengumuman itu netral. Tapi kalau ada sentimennya, bisa we can categorize to the positive or the negative one. This is another example of predictive analytics. This is performed by one of my students. Untuk memprediksi flood atau banjir di kebetulan lokasinya di Semarang. Jadi ada ini peta Semarang, ini sungai, ini tidak terlalu jelas. Ada dua bendung di sini ya yang kita amati. We have one river and one dam that we monitor using some sensors IoT and we try to predict the flood based on several data like curah hujan, ketinggian air, and also there's try to predict with tide, air pasang gitu. Kalau di Semarang itu ada kotanya mendapat bonus air pasang. So we employ several several algorithm like we using clustering, we using also multi-layer perceptrons. This is neural networks and also other types of algorithm. And we try to plot based on the data and try to know how good our estimation is. So this is another example how we can use analytics to a different case. So previously I give you example in terms of education, university, there is a public transport, and now it's about disaster management. So we try to predict flood based using analytics. This data I take from the Telkom. PT Telkom Indonesia is a state-owned telecommunication company. This is the biggest telecommunication company. They own Telkomsel, which is mobile provider. They also has a broadband service. Namanya IndiHome. Yeah, mungkin Bapak Ibu ada yang langganan IndiHome. This is the analytics perform on IndiHome data. Because in the early years of IndiHome, churn rate is high. Churn itu langganan tapi terus keluar. Jadi udah langganan bayar, then they exit. This is churn or churn rate. If the churn rate is high, then the service has a problem. Nah, IndiHome suffer from this phenomena. So in the earliest year, many people submitted, registered, but after one or two months, they said, okay, I'm finished with your service because many reasons. So the management wants to know why they exit from the service, what's the cause. This is some cause, yes, some reason why they exit from the IndiHome. This is some of the complaint that they receive. Mostly, yeah, some complaint is about the network. Yeah. Sometimes connected, sometimes disconnected. Some complaint about the service, maintenance service. You call 147, but they never came, they never come, and etc. And yeah, Telkom said after make analytics, they make some improvement, and then now the IndiHome is profitable for them. This is the last type of analytics, the prescriptive one. So like I said before, prescriptive means you want to give you recipe, resep, yeah. You told people what to do, memberikan langsung solusi. The most successful prescriptive analytics is product recommendation. Yang paling sukses dalam melakukan prescriptive analytics adalah rekomendasi produk. Ya, ini kalau Anda belanja di Amazon, there's a certain books that suggested to you. This is another example of the prescriptive analytics from a LinkedIn. Saya ditawari ya pekerjaan. Job you may be interested in. So this is two example of successful prescriptive analytics. Mostly big company, multinational company who aware the usefulness of data, they succeed using prescriptive one. Can we trust a machine? Next one. Yeah, if you have a ways like apps for giving you direction in running your company, will you follow them? Ya, yeah, kita tahu kita punya UAZ, UAZ menunjukkan arah. But if you have ways application for your company, for your university, for your research group, will you follow them? Would you trust this question? Everyone talking about big data, but largely due to its lingering complexity, adoption remains relatively low. So this is still, there's a homework. Like I said previously, only 3% using prescriptive analytics. Why? Because, yes, there's some fundamental challenge. Heterogeneous data source. Data source is vary from structure, from internal to external data source, different format, time consuming to prepare the data, almost impossible task of integrating scattered silo of data. Say you're a government, you work in certain agency, Ministry of Education. You want to know the data of the citizens who is in the Ministry of Internal Affairs, or Kementerian Dalam Negeri. It's not easy, even for the same government institution to exchange data. Even the university is also not easy, one university like OGM. Requires expert, and lastly, most of the user interaction are not intuitive. So this is five challenges of big data analytics. And I'm not sure this is even worse or not. Before performing analytics, data scientists must first format and prepare the raw data for analytics, often with more than 80% of the effort. That's Intel. Jadi, kalau kita melakukan analytics, so if we want to do analytics, 80% of our effort, of our time, of our money is for preparation, for collecting, asking others, give me our data. Oh, your data is not compatible with ours, so we have to do mapping. So that's 80% of the effort. We are not done, we are not doing analytics yet. We are not drawing graphic yet, just collecting. Jadi memulung data itu susah. 80% waktu dan biasanya tidak mendapat penghargaan. Jadi Bapak Ibu, kalau punya staff IT, berbaik-baiklah pada mereka, gitu kan? Karena 80% usaha ini ya memulung, dan memulung itu kan nggak keren, tidak bisa dibuat PowerPoint nice graphic itu kan, belum bisa di analytics. Tapi 80% itu di sini. Seperti saya cerita tadi yang perguruan tinggi analisis SNMPTN SBTN, we have to invite every single university in Indonesia, make two or three forum asking them to give data. We ask Ministry of Education, they give us their data. Ada PhD mungkin banyak yang failure, tapi datanya nggak bunyi, banyak yang salah. ada satu universitas memberikan IP mahasiswanya 3 semua satu semester, ada yang 0 semua, yang penting terisi. Jadi 3,000 IP kok sama semua, kan gak mungkin. Ada yang terisi satu mahasiswa, yang lain kosong, pokoknya asal terisi. So there's still there's a problem in this one. The last one, can machine things? Think. Misalkan mesin berpikir, ya kita mendengar artificial intelligence, big data analytics, seolah-olah mesin itu sakti gitu ya. Thinking is human feature, will AI someday really think? That's like asking if submarine swim. If you call it swimming, then robots will think, yes. Jadi, kalau submarine itu kapal selam, itu berenang ya, ya berarti bisa berpikir. Cuman kan mereka tidak berenang seperti itu. This is the Gary Kasparov versus Deep Blue. Ada dua pertandingan, catur. Gary Kasparov di pertandingan pertama menang, 4-2. Pertandingan kedua, the second match, the Deep Blue won. The Deep Blue won by 3-1. I forget the score. But the important thing is the blue wins was seen as very symbolical significant, a sign that AI was catching up to the human intelligence. Wah, udah mau menyusul ini. Tapi later analysis tends to play down ya, karena brute force. Jadi semua kemungkinan dilihat, semua kemungkinan dicoba. Itu namanya brute force. But there's another example. This is just recently, last year. Ini Google DeepMind mengalahkan AlphaGo. Dan menangnya 5-1. Kenapa lebih signifikan? Karena pertama, AlphaGo is more complicated than chess. And it involves intuitive, not only calculation, brute force, but also playing intuitively. It's more mimicking the how we think, how the brain thinks, and it also use general purpose algorithm. It calls deep neural network. The AlphaGo raise interest what so called general AI. So if you ask question about what this machine can thinks, usually related to AI, artificial intelligence. Actually, there's three types of AI. First is artificial narrow intelligence. It's very specific. Computer who play chess, computer who play AlphaGo, yeah. Self-driving car, we are good at it. AlphaGo is very good. AlphaGo itu sangat bagus bermain Go. Deep Blue bermain catur. Tapi dia suruh buat kopi nggak bisa. Suruh masak nggak bisa. Yeah. Nah, itu karena AI-nya itu very specific. Artificial General Intelligence. Nah, ini yang sering disebut strong AI. Jadi, orang itu strong AI. Kita bisa, kita main catur bisa, kita dengerin orang presentasi bisa, dengerin presentasi sambil WA juga bisa, ya kan? Pakai baju bisa, ngajar kuliah bisa, sambil ngelamun juga bisa, ya kan? Kita, dan kita sadar, we are aware, we are conscious. That's a sign of intelligence. We are not there yet. AI belum ke situ. Ya, mesin belum ke situ. Ya. Nanti diskusinya bisa banyak lah, entah hardware-nya nggak cukup. Karena komputer sekarang itu, recent computers only as strong as mouse. Ya, otak. Otak tikus. And then artificial super intelligence, smarter than human. Nah, kalau sudah ke sini saya nggak tahu manusia masih ada atau enggak. And lastly, big data analytics is the combination of the artificial narrow intelligence. So don't worry, kita masih di narrow intelligence, but of course the promise is bright, karena intelligence dalam machine akan selalu berkembang. Saya kira itu Pak Edi. Sudah, sorry, sudah melebihi. Terima kasih. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you.